third panel discussion this morning is all about market analysis and consumer behaviour. It's understanding Middle Eastern demand for paper and stationery. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, could we please put our hands together for the first panel this morning, our first moderator, Ritesh Gupta, who's marketing from Etihad Paper Mills.
All right. Thank you, Laura, for inviting us on the forum. At the foremost, I'd also like to thank Paper World Middle East for conducting this session over here. I believe we're going to have a very exciting discussion. The topic is very, very relevant in the context of the Middle East market because, obviously, it's a growing market. Seen a lot of changes over the last couple of, years. And it's poised for growth. I would say it's probably one of the biggest growth engines that we are going to see in coming years, especially with UAE, Saudi opening up even further as compared to what it was previously. So allow me to introduce the panel to you. We have Mr. Noble. He's the owner of Pencil Office Supply. We have Mr. Haider Ali. He's the CEO of Capital Envelope. Mr. Chandan Singh. He's the CEO of Dofar Global. We've got Mr. Murli, he is the director at Alia Muhammad, and Mr. Samir, who has a very diverse experience in procurement because he's been the CCO of Masar Printing, as well as currently he's part of Bulugal Maram Stationery, which is looking at expanding growth into tertiary markets in and around the Gulf. If we could have a small moment to introduce yourselves, gentlemen, we could start off the discussion.
Hello. 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 Hi, everyone. I'm Noble Nainan. I'm the founder and managing director of Pencil Office Supply. We have two other companies also that we are part of. We have a company called Kagaz Trading, which is an wholesale division of paper products selling across 25 countries. And now we are coming up with a new retail outlet also called Rocket Stationery. We've been in business for the last 13 to 14 years. We are the channel partners for IPM as well. It's great to be here. I'll pass on the chance to Mr. Ali.
Hello. Hello. Good morning, everyone. My name is Ali Haider. I'm the CEO of Capital Envelope. We are the largest envelope manufacturer in the Middle East and Africa with a capacity in excess of 1.5 billion envelopes. We would like to thank Ritesh for calling us, and we are one of the key partners for developing the envelope business, not just here, but all around the world, which includes Europe and North America. I have been in Dubai for 47 years. I'm not as old as I look. I'm actually quite young, but anyway, thank you.
I can't say I'm the youngest one, but I could say here that I'm the youngest one. Very good morning to every one of you all. My name is Chandan Singh. I'm the CEO of Dofar Global. Our journey started in the year 2007 when we embarked in the journey. People were loving us royally, and from there we started our journey until now. We have got 67% market share in institution. First, we embarked in hygiene business, and in 2021 we embarked in stationery business. Within 1 year, 3 months to be specific, we have got 33% market share in cut size paper to be specific. And now we are diversifying in other SKUs of stationery business. In the year 2024, we have planned for diversifying in food business as well. I come from India, and I started my journey with Parle, worked with Henkel, and here we started in the year 2007. And till now, by grace of God, teams is really working out hard, and I take this humble pride that because of the team, whatever we are doing, we are doing with it. I pass it on to Mr. Murli now.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. So, my name is Murli Emma. I head the paper division at Alia Muhammad Trading Company. Our company is about 50 years old, and we have got a diversified portfolio. In the paper division, we are about a couple of us who are with about a total of about 65 years of experience in paper industry. We are very predominant in making the transactions happen, like we facilitate
the business between the manufacturer and the importer. We are very strong in Ethiopia, and in fact, we are also channel partners for Messe Frankfurt for Ethiopia and other African countries, which are going to come through. We also represent multiple stakeholders from across the globe, because we are present not only in Africa, Middle East, GCC, as well as South America and European region. So that's a brief. Thank you. I pass it on to Mr. Sami.
Assalamu alaikum. Good morning, everybody. I am from actually the printing industry mainly. I'm in the printing industry since 1996, which when I came to Dubai. Before that, I'm in the technology related to the printing as well. I was the founding member, one of four members who started Masar Printing and Publishing, and Mohammed Al Rashid Holy Quran Printing Center. Recently, we started the partnership with Al Ittihad from the very early beginning, starting from Masar, and we established two companies now, Bulugh Al Maram Company for trading and Al Jazeera Mutakamila. We cover a decent area, and we represent exclusive products with Al Ittihad, including copy paper and special paper for printing the Holy Quran. I thank British for inviting us today, and hopefully we'll have a successful event together. Have a nice day. Thank you.
All right, gentlemen. Thank you so much for the introduction. So as you can see, we have one of the pioneers in the industry who has set foot in manufacturing and has made sure that there are quality stationery products produced in the United Arab Emirates. Mr. Haider here. I would like to ask you, sir, you know, what was your understanding, or what was the, you know, market analysis that you did at that time in terms of consumer behavior, supply chain dynamics, which brought about the establishment of Capital Envelope?
Thank you, Ritesh. So we started in the year 2000 as four envelope manufacturers. Most of our supply chain was coming out of Europe, and some of it was coming out of the Far East. And over the years, we grew, and we became a specialized envelope manufacturer, where not just volume, but the entire range of products. The Middle East and Gulf markets, along with Africa, were still developing, so we grew, and today we are the dominant player in the market. We went into strategic partnership with IPM a few years ago. We developed specialized paper for the envelope industry, which opened global markets for IPM, as well as helped us along our journey. So markets here are still growing. The paper industry is not going anywhere. It is a big myth. Paper is the most sustainable product. It's fully biodegradable, unlike many other products. So we're seeing books are coming back. We're seeing, some of the products are going off, but paper isn't going anywhere. It's here to stay. And IPM is producing a very high-quality paper, where my fellow colleagues, I'm sure, will agree. And we hope to keep growing with them. And we're growing not just here in Europe and North America as well. Thank you.
All right. So how have you seen, stationery evolving? Say, a buying decision. This question is more towards Noble. You know, you've started off business way after where Mr. Haider has set up. So what he brought about is, yes, we have supplies coming in from Europe, so you're more towards a stock and sell model, right? Are you seeing any evolving trends, and how exactly is stock and sell working today? Like, how often are you stocking up products? What's the demand pipeline looking like?
What we will do is we will discuss mainly with copy paper. So we have had an amazing journey working with IPM since 2020, actually. And regardless what people say, what we've seen is we've never been able to keep enough stock of paper compared to the orders that we've been receiving. As rightful what Mr. Ali was saying, that the paper is going is just a myth, the demand is at an all-time high. We have two verticals that we work with. We have a corporate division where we work with around 150 plus government departments across the UAE, and we have a wholesale division where we work with around 500 to 600 stationaries across the UAE. Now, in terms of demand and supply, in UAE, what we normally see is, because of the export business that happens from UAE, there's always a shortage of product that comes into UAE, you know. So working with a local partner has really helped us to ensure that there is timely availability of product, and IPM has been a great partner at that.
Right. So what you're trying to say is you need to have inventory, but it needs to be a rotating inventory. Is that what you're trying to say?
We've kind of spent a lot of time in perfecting the turnover ratio of the stock that we hold. Earlier, the equation was that normally you need to have 3x your monthly sale in inventory. You know, if you have, let's say, 3 inventory, you can do 1 in sale on a monthly basis. But currently what we do is, with 1 in stock, we do 3 times the sale on a monthly basis. So it's all about the stock turnover ratio, I think, which we
right.
kind of managed to perfect it.
Right. So, you know, I'd like to ask Mr. Murli over here, how exactly are you seeing, you know, because you're working across multiple markets and you're an enhancer in the sense that wherever you see demand, you know, maybe with the likes of people who are there across diverse geographies, their buying patterns are different. So how exactly are you working towards, you know, coming in?
Thank you, Ritesh. Basically, when I see Middle East and the Gulf markets, of course, we all look at the growth aspect. I think it's going to touch $3 billion in the next 5 years, and with about maybe $800-900 million going to be higher up in the next 4 years. What I still foresee is, unlike Mr. Ali here, we don't see many entrepreneurs who are bringing in manufacturing into the, you know, aspect. There are a lot of challenges here, but very few manufacturers who can, you know, make things happen within their, you know, confined market. What is happening now is, excuse me, Middle East and GCC is mainly getting into import market. So they're so predominantly import buyers. But like with what Noble said, the inventory costs go up.
Correct.
You get, you know, a lot of knee-jerk reactions from freight, open freight, strike, geopolitical situations. So, but there are opportunities. Opportunities in eco-friendly products, you know, and manufacturing, converting rather. You are a manufacturer, but
correct.
I'm sure not many are going to come into manufacturing fine paper per se, but there is opportunity
there
for packaging, right? So there are opportunities, but who's going to tap it? Cost of financing is very high, like the last time we were discussing. Cost of financing going up, taxation coming up. There are many factors, many challenges. So one has to really look at a long-term perspective, think that this is here to stay. We know this is the market, this is the growth, and we look at it that way.
Right. So, Mr. Samar, you know, we know that Basar consumes a lot of paper, right? How have you seen, you know, because you just don't buy paper, you are forecasting demand and therefore you order paper, or you used to order paper. So at what point were you looking at that my inventory is at this level and I have to stop ordering this specific grade or this specific GSM and try to switch it over? So how was that kind of, you know, the logic working for you? Like, what was going on in your mind when you were actually sitting down, taking inventory counts, and then placing your orders? Because you used to move, and you still move a lot of volume. So what was going on in your mind at that time in terms of demand planning, in terms of inventory planning?
When we talk about planning for material for any production environment, your main target is to buy the material whenever it's at its best level. but this is a very common challenge in every industry. You have to manage your cash flow as well. So the certainty about the orders, about the market, has taken very badly recently. Many budgets were canceled, many projects were almost there and they didn't happen. And what happened after that is kind of a chaos where you suddenly get a confirmed order out of nowhere that's been laying for the past 2 years, and you have to rush and order, and you don't like it. Suppliers don't like this. And either we have to lose the order, or we have to buy at very high price.
Correct.
Then you try. I mean, it's a very challenging market, we have to admit it. It's not as smooth and usual as before. Even now, as an agent for paper, selling material and selling other types of, even stationery and some other solutions, the same challenge is there. The market is not well, organized. Ability to forecast is weaker, especially for products that are not off the shelf, especially for customized sizes, reels, and one of the challenges that we faced recently is the diameter of the reel. Imagine, some markets they will accept 120, some markets this is not valid at all.
Okay.
So this is a common situation today. It's very challenging. It needs coordination. I always say that the chain should communicate stronger together. The manufacturer, the agent, even the client, sharing information and being more transparent helps the business a lot.
Right.
And more communication among even competition sometimes. I talk a lot to competition, and it's very healthy. And it leads to a better market understanding and better performance for everybody.
Right. So, one of the key challenges that comes across in an import-oriented model is, when you're a regular consumer of paper or any other stationery item, is you don't know what the demand is, right? You don't know when, say my son tells me, Dad, my ink bottle got finished, I need to go buy ink. I can't say that, as kids are, and these are basically the segments that we are targeting with this kind of a product, Suddenly the pen doesn't work, and then we have to go and order some pens, or we have, stuff like that. But the challenge that comes out of this, and Mr. Chandan, is you, as a person or as an entity who has to be in the market to have somebody believe that you can deliver on time and you have the product with you, how do you work around having one order in your warehouse, one on the water, or one in transit, and then one under production?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for this question. It's really wonderful, and we need to really introspect on this area. Technically, if you would see, there's an online and offline market contributing to the business. And if you look at deeply, if you go and buy stationery for yourself, you end up buying a pen, pencil, which is worth of 10 dirhams, 15 dirhams, 20 dirhams. It becomes technically difficult to manage that 20 dirhams delivery to be done.
Correct.
Until if you do not add any other charges to it, which is the delivery charges. If you are adding the delivery charges, it's fine, but it turns out to be an expensive proposition for the person or end consumer who would be opting for this. If he is willing to pay off, then it's fine. There is another thing which you just now mentioned. It's a momentary moment. If your son is asking that I need a razor right now, so he needs it right now. And you can't just think that you'll place an order and wait for 3 hours if you are delivering in 3 hours or the next day to get things delivered. So it is a kind of a change which we see. We cannot expect, because of the online business taking up in this part of the world, you can expect a revolutionary change. Certainly, it is going to be a revolutionary change. But change is imperative. It will continue to be happening. And I foresee online, offline market is going to be there, and it will continue growing. But there is a tweaking is required in the business model, and which would certainly change over the period because of the continuous improvement from the market itself.
Right. Mr. Chandan, you touched on a very very interesting topic. But before we get to the online side of things, there's one thing I'd like to just try and address. You know, when we are looking at commodities such as paper and stationery, not many consumers realize that these are perishable items. You know, you cannot just have a box of ink pens at home, which will last you for the next 10 years. There is a shelf life associated to it. So, Noble, as somebody who's, you know, catering to a wide market, how often do you look at, again, it comes back to your how many turns you're getting in the inventory. And what role does product expiry play on your, because it eventually means that you've not been able to plan for something, or you need to go back to the principal for some sort of a rebate to get rid of goods that are just going to get expired. So how exactly is it that you plan around this?
Yeah, to ensure stock availability is something which is literally impossible. Being in the stationery business, I think my kids have been started school maybe last 4 to 5 years back. Not even a single time have I been able to bring them stationery from my company. Every time they need something, I have to run to a different stationery and get it for them. You know, not even a single time. You know, I mean, every time I come back home, they're like, "Dad, I need glue sticks. Dad, I need pencils. Dad, I need that." You know, so I mean, when it comes to my kids' school, every single stationery product has been brought from outside. Nothing from pencil. You know.
I have
the same issue when we go for meetings and stuff also, you know. I mean, being a stationery person, when you are, you know, going for a meeting, maybe for signing a contract, that's when you realize, okay, I'm not carrying a pen with me, you know. And then your only option is to go to a nearby stationery, buy the pen, and then go to that particular place. So this happens for me every single time, you know. It's not just at one point of time, you know. In terms of perishable items, what we do is we have a very tight policy when it comes to aging of inventory, and we have a very we have an audit team who literally sits on our head when it comes to managing the inventory. You know, so every year, I mean, unlike other stationery, what we do is every year we kind of write off all the items which are valued below a certain amount. Since we work in the corporate sector, we are forced to supply products in loose quantities as well. We might have a customer who might tell us, you know what, I need 3 erasers or 5 pieces of pen. You know, we're not at, we don't have an option to tell them no. So what we do every year is we do a in-depth or a very detailed inventory counting end of the year. All the items below a certain value, ideally any SKU which is below, let's say 1,000 dirhams is removed from the inventory. Any damaged item is removed from the inventory. And if there is any item, see, when it comes to stationery, I think the perishable items are less, yeah. But we have a cold storage unit where we keep the adhesive-related products like post-its or glue sticks and stuff. I mean, when if you go to any normal stationery, the biggest challenge that they face always is the managing inventory. Just literally impossible to do it in a decent way, you know. I mean, we've been approached by many stationeries that have been put on for sale of lately. But once you visit them, to put a value to those stationeries is literally impossible. Now, that is something that we don't want to happen in our case. At any point of time, any external agencies, or we get visited by a lot of government departments from time to time. You know, I mean, how any customer who's visited us at any point of time will, in that instance, he will realize what is the difference of pencil compared to somebody else. You know, everything has to be organized correctly. It's not be any damaged products in your warehouse. I mean, we take a lot of care when it comes to perishable items and maintaining our inventory.
Now, thank you. I'm going to flip this question around. You know, as producers, Mr. Ali, how are you planning around your demand cycle? Because there's a certain amount of stock you need to carry as safety stock, and also to you, Mr. Samar, when you were planning printing jobs, right? Certain amount of safety stocks need to be carried when safety stock. You know, when you are basic, regular bread and butter items that you need to carry with you every now and then. But then customization and branding is one part of the thing where Noble and Mr. Chandan would be part of that, because they are heavily involved in promoting brands. And somehow, you're involved in creating a brand, sir. And you, sir, are also one who has to follow the guidelines for a customer, which is his own specific brand. So how does this work out in terms of planning? And what's the healthy mix? Maybe 90% customized, 10% standard, or 90% standard, 10% customized. How do you understand and then go ahead and pitch that product?
When you are involved in a manufacturing process, in production, you have to have always, we calculate it this way. We look at our machine capacity, our maximum production capacity for the lead time that usually it takes to bring new material. So if I need 8 weeks to prepare for a new job from scratch, I should always have a stock valid for operation, for full operation of the production plant for 10 weeks.
10 weeks.
Yeah, of course.
Right.
Of course. You have to be able to run continually because your main asset is time.
Correct.
So if you lose your biggest asset in production, regardless how much margin you put, you will start losing.
It starts coming in there.
And
right.
You lose from your net. We've learned this the hard way. In Masar only 17 years, and before that in other places. You have to focus on the time factor. And you have to add the risk of logistics usually. And I think everybody agrees it never happens exactly as planned. You will always have challenges, excuses, and now we are ready for this in advance. We know that it will never happen, and we never promise what we are promised in delivery. So if I talk to you, you tell me tomorrow, I tell him after 3 days.
Right. We have to buffer up, and keep expectations.
Even if you deliver in time, this is an added value. So you make it as a bonus rather than a delay. You have to keep your word. In business in general, I believe the biggest important, the most important factor is keeping your word with the client, not letting him down, supplying what he needs. And this is the main factor. So basically, you have to make sure that you keep running. And regardless how many precautions you take, how much planning you do, how much forecast you do, there will be some hiccups.
Mr. Ali, your thoughts on
this? So raw material planning is fundamental to our existence. We plan 1 year ahead of time. So we will partner up with paper suppliers, glue suppliers, all the raw materials that are required 1 year ahead of time. We will give them forecasting, which is reviewed every quarter. I'm sure you're aware of this because we work with you guys. So we don't do any spot buying. We know we base things on previous year's demand, and we project forward. I would say 90 to 95% of the time, we're pretty much there. I mean, we accommodate. We try and keep minimalistic stock because that's a essentially your working capital. Any growth opportunities that we have, there we are a bit conservative, but we partner with our raw material suppliers. I mean, we've been working with our suppliers for 15, 20 years. We don't change suppliers. And yes, as my colleague said that it can be difficult at times, but because we are dealing with a very basic commodity, we don't really end up in too much of trouble as far as raw material planning is concerned. And as far as obsolete product, envelopes don't typically get obsolete. The only risk factor is the glue. But with glue technology that's been changing, you have an envelope which can easily last a few years. We use hot melt, which is much better than the cold melt technology. And frankly, if you end up with excess or old stock, you just sell it at a discount. But this is, most manufacturers of envelopes, you will not find them with any obsolete stock. I would be surprised.
Right.
So,
understand. Thank you. So, Mr. Murli, now this is directly in your alley. Right? Mr. Murli? Yeah. So, I think the overall consensus that's coming here is, A, we have to, in order to service better, you need to have
some amount of stuff, A.
And then you need to under-promise your customer and over-promise in a way to the...
I wouldn't say that.
So how do you...
Basically, you see, what is happening is the market is in the trust.
Right.
People are thinking it's a developed market, but unfortunately, it is still lagging in various... It's stuck with its own, you know, what is called chains. So it's not able to erupt out and come into a developed stage. So you have buying patterns, there are professionals, but unfortunately they are unable to be supported by the supply chain. So the entire, like he was saying, the entire chain has to change. For that change to happen, everybody should be in the same platform, thought process, that just in time is important.
Correct. It comes down to even your inventory cost and finance cost. Now, Mr. Chandran.
Thank you so much. It's really adding a lot of spice to the conversation, and I enjoy it thoroughly. But we do annual projection and we do the rolling plan, so this facilitates our planning. Eventually, we always believe in technology and technological advancements, which enable us to exercise better control in business. I'm sure we all of us are agree that artificial intelligence are taking place in the market, and it is time that, as I was saying, that evolutionary change is required. So we are also looking at going to artificial intelligence, which could help us to project the business.
Yeah.
And also it gives you a kind of insight where you would know which month is going to be outlier month, and which month is going to be as it is. So you have a 6 year of patterns which would enable you to know when the outlier months were there and when the outlier months were not there. And on the basis of that, it is easy to project. But I would certainly say that there will be a room of improvement even if you go for artificial intelligence.
Now I'll add some spice to the mix, right? We've all been just touching around the subject of online retail, online marketplaces, demand aggregators. Now, what I've seen, I believe, and maybe you know, you have far more experience than what I have at the moment, is innovation and disruptive innovation of technology happens first in the U.S., then it comes to Europe, and then it comes to the Middle East, and then it goes to Africa and you know, all the other places. Right, that's basically how the chain of, I would say, dissemination of technology and buying patterns typically happens. One of the trends that's coming up right now, in a very big way, is the concept of having a retail outlet, right, is moving out because information is available online. You have standardized products. The only thing that changes is a brand, right? So it creates a problem that you've got a new entrant probably who people don't know and probably is one of the better products that's available. So how do they make an entry into the market? And how do you see this sort of a trend developing here in the UAE or in the Middle East? Wherein you've got multiple demand centers across different countries. Yes, it's a region, but then each country has its own cycle. So how do you see online retail coming up here? And in what format? Are we looking at it on a B2B platform that's coming in? Are we looking at it as somebody who wants to order a ream of paper or a pack of pens or, you know, some sort of generic stationery items at the beginning of the year? I'd like to have your thought, Mr. Chandran, on this.
I would say we are going through a transformational journey in this part of the world. We have learned in this market that, let's take example of business to business. Now, if you have an office, you do have a specific requirement, specific link pertaining to stationery, and also your day-to-day requirements like tea, coffee, and just the diet.
Correct, yeah?
So we cannot just say specific to stationery. So when we look at this, and there is a consolidated requirement in the office. Now, what they are doing is, if there is a big corporate house is there and they have a full building, there is a new development is taking place where one company is taking care of the whole store,
okay,
in the same building, and then they are distributing the cross building. Now, what happens? You are creating a store over there, and then you are distributing in the same building. Now, there are two things is happening. A company doesn't need to work in terms of having inventory. They have inventory at downstairs. So if they need something, they'll just make a call and the things are delivered at their office immediately. So these are the changes which is taking place.
Right. I'd just like to ask you a question here.
Yeah.
How important is branding in this kind of a scenario?
Sorry?
How important is branding?
Yeah.
When you have a scenario where you're able to call something and you need it at the moment. Do you think brands are important here?
It's a tricky question, I must say. It all depends on the need. If I'm hungry, I need food. I can't say that I need this specific one. So if they are asking specifically to a certain brand, if that is not available and they need it badly, then certainly they are okay with any alternative. And that's there across the world. So it depends on what they need.
So now, Noble. We are looking at, I'd like to just take this discussion forward. So we are looking at something which is an office-centric solution for B2B.
Okay.
Right? Why is it today that you still have the importance of brands, wherein if you look at certain developed markets, where B2B is, I would say, a major chunk of the business that has gone online, and these retailers have taken it to white labeling and have started moving out of brands. Do you see this kind of a trend of online B2B coming up here in the GCC going forward? If at all, when? I don't know. I hope it's not whether it's going to happen. When it's going to happen, what do you think?
I'll give a very good advice to people who are planning to get into the online stationery business. Drop the idea. It will save you a lot of money. We worked with around, I think, at the time Amazon took over Souq.com, there were a lot of, I don't know the ideal term for those, but a lot of people who used to work with Amazon in the US who basically came down to Dubai or Abu Dhabi and started listing products and selling products through Amazon and stuff. So we've been contacted by a lot of those people as well as a lot of online platforms who wanted to do stationery. What we've realized in the process is, other than us spending a lot of time giving them the information, the SKU details, the barcodes, the product photos, there was hardly any conversion that was happening over there. It reached a point that today if anybody from the online space comes to us and tells us, we want to list your product, and my only reply is that, okay, we will give you the prices, nothing more. You want the product photos, you want the product details, please, you will have to do it yourself. Because I wasted a considerable amount of my team's time thinking digital is the future. Contrary to that, what we are doing right now is we are getting into retail right now. And we are starting physical shops across UAE. The main reason is stationery is an impulse purchase. It is not something that, we have the concept of bakala to supermarkets in UAE. We are so used to calling the supermarket and saying, get me a bread delivered to my house, And when we are living in a country where convenience matters most, online space for stationery, I don't see it happening anytime. I don't think even in my generation I don't see that happening coming through.
In the region.
So I'm betting on traditional brick and mortar shops going forward.
We see this happening in the hypermarket. By the way, we were most of the big names in the hypermarket. We don't want to mention names, but you know them. They're everywhere, and we were printing millions of hypermarket booklets,
yes.
And that was really going unbelievably high. And our biggest challenge was during the season to manage to print as many. Suddenly, out of nowhere, we started seeing a drop, and when Corona came, it went extreme. and everybody was saying that this will be the alternative and everything will be done online. Immediately, numbers started falling, and even after the crisis was over, numbers still were falling continually for many products. They started coming back with shorter runs, everybody I'm saying, most of the hypermarket, and every product that they put on the printed booklet, at the point of sale, it was the sales were going up significantly.
Correct.
And now they are back. I would not say like before with the same volume of printing, but it was very obvious.
So these are like targeted hits for certain specific products or certain inventory.
If you look at these booklets, they are 48 pages and sometimes more than that. And it's not one or two; there are hundreds of products,
correct.
And it makes a huge effect.
Right. So, you know, one of the developments, you know, it's good that you brought it up, is it's so difficult for you to plan up ahead. And specifically on the printing side, you have machines that have come up today in which you can actually print a novel the moment the order is placed online.
Yes, yes.
Right?
But the technology, you can see that most of the printers, we have more than, I think, 400 printers in the UAE, and most of these printers are set up to conventional printing, which is basically medium run. I would not say high. High run printers are very less. So these people are not equipped for print on demand.
Right.
It's picking up, yes, but it's still not very well developed. I wouldn't say even 20%, because the technology being used is a little expensive. But print on demand is a huge solution, definitely. I don't agree 100% with Nobel that dropped the idea, but it's not yet ready.
Right.
I totally agree. It's not ready, but it is coming, and it will have a huge impact, but it will need time. It's a matter of mindset. It's a matter of culture. It's a matter of how you are used to do your consuming behavior, and this is it. And regarding the brand, it's priority, you know. The first priority is the quality of the product. Then comes the brand, or then comes the accessibility of the product. You have
right.
it next to you, you will get it.
Right.
So,
one of the things which Mr. Samar brought up is, even if you have an online presence, or an online marketplace today, I need an eraser now. You know, I need a pencil now. Is anybody geared to do that? I think only U.S. is the concept where you have Amazon Prime. Now, well, within a couple of hours, they are able to do that.
Yes,
but we are still miles away on that. Now, I personally feel, and you know, sorry, my view is a little bit different from your novel here. I think we have to slice the market and not look at it as one contiguous market, right? We need to segment it. Now, I personally believe, and this is what Mr. Chandran brought about, is you have captive demand, something which Mr. Ali loves to do in this sense that he's able to plan out up ahead. It gives a base demand for him, and for him at the end of the day, I don't know, sir, please correct me if I'm wrong here. So from a production standpoint, whether you have a white box or a white label good or a branded good, is it?
So let me just touch on this e-commerce.
Yeah.
Let me give you some statistics. The e-commerce business in the GCC by 2025 is expected to be about $10 billion. The global economy stands today in excess of $1 trillion. E-commerce is coming, and it's coming fast. As Mr. Nobel has mentioned, I don't know when it's coming, but it's coming very fast. Oil is going to finish. Electric cars are going to take over, whether it's good for the environment, not good for the environment. This is dictated by the mega corporates of the world. Just to put it in perspective with packaging and how paper plays a role in this, 80% of all packaging right now is coming either in a box or a plastic package. Only 20% is all sorts of other materials. In the next 5 years, plastic is expected to reduce. The boxes, which are corrugated cotton, is expected to reduce because they're not efficient. They're expensive. They use up a lot of space. You buy a tiny little thing, and it's going to come in a huge box.
Yes.
So actually, you need envelopes. That's where we come in. Quick. Slides in, two-step packing as opposed to a six-step packing. But I'm not going to just promote the envelope concept. The paper industry is going to be challenged because it's a lot more expensive than plastic. Yeah. Plastic is not going anywhere. As much as my children keep getting after me to recycle and whatnot, it was the greatest invention of the 20th century, and it's here to stay because it's very, very cheap. And all companies, the likes of Amazon, Alibaba, they're profit-driven. As terrible as this may sound, they claim that they care about the environment, but I question that. And as far as delivery times are concerned, Alibaba, along with a number of logistic companies in China, they have made an investment of $300 million to basically reduce delivery time anywhere in the world to less than 4 days, which is actually going to be quite a challenge. And these are, this is the future. This is where we're going. Like we said, we need a eraser today, now, you know. And this is, we're going to get there. I mean, we have to accept this whether we like it or not. This is the future. And, you know, e-commerce is here to stay. And I think paper will have a good share of that market because, like I said, it's a sustainable product. And I just want to say this, I want to get this myth out there. All these comments that you hear, save the trees. This is a totally nonsensical comment. Nobody is doing anything to the trees. The trees, the forests are growing globally. There are very strict rules around this. And let me tell you, 50% of the trees that are cut go into construction, 40% goes into fuel, only 10% comes into paper. And of that 10%, 0.3% is envelope. The rest
are
all fellow colleagues. Thank you.
No, I think, Sir played a very important subject with regards to wood, sustainability. I think there's a talk later on sustainability as well. I saw a sustainability platform here. One of the things that's missing, I personally feel, and please feel free to add on, is general awareness about what is sustainability. You know, is it something that I'm using recycled material? Is that sustainable? Yes. So, first thing is we need to define or have a common understanding of what are sustainable practices. A. How do you measure them? Is B. And C is how do you report them? Because if you're not able to define an objective, measure it, then you cannot communicate it further.
Can I? Sure. So, the main thing about sustainability is recycling. The investment has to happen in recycling. We have this bad habit, whether it's a chocolate wrapper or a plastic bag, we will just throw it away. The investment has to be in recycling. Because you can't get rid of certain materials, no matter how much you try, because it's not cost-effective. It is changing consumer habits, which is very, very difficult. So to bring a disciplined line, investing in recycling systems, especially for plastic, is very expensive. Paper, even if you throw it, it's fully biodegradable.
Yes.
So recycling is the name of the game.
Right. So, you know, I think everybody can join me in saying that we should all use more paper.
We should stop using double side printouts, you know? Always use single side printouts.
Sure. I think, gentlemen, we've unfortunately had to run out of time, but we've had a very engaging session. I hope even the audience feels like that. I hope that was what it was, right? And thank you again, gentlemen, for your time. It's been a pleasure to have you on board and have such an engaging discussion here. I don't know if you have time for questions or...
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, what a fantastic way to start day one, Paper World ME. Please can we put our hands together for all of our panelists. It was a really interesting discussion. I'm so sorry, guys, we have run out of time, so we don't have time for any questions. But, guys, I'm sure you'll be hanging around a little bit if anybody wants to talk to you or ask you any questions. And thank you so much, guys. Once again, could we please put our hands together, everyone, for our first panel discussion.